Welcome back to Applied Mathematical Finance, and we are in a section where we started discussing interest rates. So we already had a first session introducing the basics. I will give maybe a 5 to 10 minutes review of this, and now I try to give you a little bit more intuition for the objects. So we started defining interest rates by defining a single object, the zero coupon bond. Yeah? So this is the zero coupon bond. It's the value that you observe in time little t. Okay, so this is where we observe the value. Since I think of everything as being a random variable, I observe it in little t in state little omega, the value of receiving 1 unit of currency in time t2. So this object exists until time t2. And if you take a look at how this value looks like, so for a fixed time, so for a fixed little t and omega. So what do I observe as a function of capital T? So as a function of the maturity. So this here is a P of capital T at a fixed time. Yeah? So if we are in little t, so I would observe that the value is 1. So trivially, we have that receiving 1 unit of currency in little t, observed in little t, is just 1. Okay. And if interest rates are positive, so assuming positive interest rates, I would expect that this curve somehow decays as a function of maturity. Yeah, so maybe something like this. So maybe I don't draw it so steep. Yeah, so maybe have it a little bit flattened. So maybe something like this, okay? Okay, which means that if I have to wait longer for the money, there is more interest to be paid. Yeah, so which is then actually deduced from the value since I receive a fixed amount. Yeah, so I don't receive 1 plus interest, I receive a fixed amount, so the value decays. And now we just, so this curve contains all the information of the interest rates that we know at time little t. In this state omega, and what was following is just an alternative way of expressing this curve. Okay, since you know that the curve starts at 1, so I know that PTT is 1, it's, for example, sufficient to know the derivative of the curve, because then I can reconstruct the curve by integrating. Yeah. So if you know the derivative of the curve, you know that the value is 1 plus the integral from little t to capital T over the derivative. And actually, interest rates are nothing else as a way of expressing the derivative. So you can ask yourself, okay, what is the difference between 1 and that value? Okay, which is something like a finite difference for a derivative. But I can also ask myself, what is the difference of that point here and that point, which is the derivative at a future point in terms of maturity, yeah, so at a different maturity. And all these derivatives describe me the curve. Yeah, since I know that the curve is attached to 1. And interest rates are nothing else that we describe this curve in terms of its derivative. There was one remark I made, and I would like to repeat it here. I consider this as a guaranteed payment. So at this point of the lecture, I do not consider default. So it is not possible that the counterpart goes bankrupt and I don't get my money back. Yeah. So everything is risk-free here in our setup. We will maybe later relax this, which will give rise to multiple interest rate curves. So going back and expressing now this curve of the zero coupon bond price in terms of derivatives, the first object we looked at was the forward bond. So actually we don't express the derivative as a difference, say f of t1 minus f of t2. We express it as a ratio. So this is pt1 divided by pt2. Okay, so a ratio is also something like a difference. So for example, if you take the logarithm of PT1 divided by PT2, it's the logarithm of PT1 minus the logarithm of PT2. So a ratio is like differentiating the logarithm. And we introduced this object, yeah? So the forward bond is the bond at the end of the period, so at the higher maturity, divided by the bond at the smaller maturity. So this number, if interest rates are positive, would be smaller than one, because this object actually has a nice interpretation. It is the amount we have to invest in time t1 to receive 1 unit in time t2. So it corresponds to a value that we can construct by a certain trading strategy, well, by a certain portfolio, no? Namely buying two bonds. And this is then like the zero coupon bond price, the price that we have to pay forward in time at a future point in time. One important aspect was, and that was on all our slides so far, that the time here we is a little t. So everything is observed at little t, which means that we express this curve here as being observed in little t. So little t does not change. Yeah? It's just the maturity that changes the time when we receive money. So endowed with this interpretation that the ratio of these two is the amount that we have to pay in t1 to receive 1 unit in t2. Yeah? So it's actually clear that if we just multiply the whole thing with the inverse, if we invest or pay 1 unit at time t1, we receive at time t2 the inverse, yeah, 1 multiplied with the inverse, which is pt1, the number that is larger than pt2 divided by pt2, so that is larger than 1. And now with this interpretation, that amount here is the interest rate. Yeah? So that amount here would be our interest rate. Well, going back to this curve, yeah, so you see that the curve here has a downward slope. Yeah? So if I say the first derivative is somewhat as the interest rate, you see, okay, that is negative here. Yeah? So it is minus the derivative that is the interest rate. So how much do I have to pay, yeah, on interest if I wait longer? Yeah? And pay is negative. Yeah? So, so somehow the interest rates are minus the derivative of this curve. And since it's not the derivative in terms of a difference, it is the derivative in terms of the ratio, it's minus the derivative of the logarithm. And that scheme also appeared then in our definition. So now we defined different interest rates by looking at actually how is this larger than one. Okay, so and let me just quickly step through this. So one was the simple rate, and for a forward period, it was the simple forward rate, and I just call it the forward rate, which is what do I get in excess to one. Yeah, so in excess to one, I get a certain amount, and I measure this amount in a per time basis. So I define L as being that amount divided by the time period length. Okay, so that is that this forward rate is the bond at the beginning of the interval minus the bond at the end of the interval. So this looks like a finite difference. Yeah, so you see that actually this here is like minus the derivative, okay, minus because you have to flip the two, yeah, it's minus the derivative of the curve, but it's the derivative divided by the curve itself, and you know derivative divided by itself is the derivative of the logarithm. Okay, so this is already intuition, yeah, interest rate is something like the negative of the slope of the bond curve, maybe in a log coordinate, and this guy here is this object in a finite difference sense. The next object we defined, yeah. So I'm just going through the definitions, and while going through this, giving you a little bit more intuition, was to look at the same thing exactly in this log interpretation, yeah. And it's just another form of expressing the derivative of this curve. I don't express the derivative of the curve itself. I express it as the derivative of the logarithm. And also in a finite difference manner. Yeah. So it is the difference of, it is the difference of the logarithm at the bond at the end minus the logarithm at the bond at the beginning divided by the interval, the maturity interval. So these are all finite differences which somehow encode the slope of the curve. Next object was that we make the interval infinitesimal small, and then this object would converge to derivative, yeah, the partial derivative, and we can make this in both definitions, actually in this definition and also in this definition. So that was then the next object which we defined, the instantaneous forward rate. So while the other interest rates are somehow for a fixed period, the tangent. Yeah. So this is for an infinitesimal point. It's the secant. Yeah. So while the other rates were for a fixed interval, the secant, this is for a fixed point, the tangent. It's an alternative way of expressing this curve. And going back to the picture here, since you know that the curve is attached to one, so PTT is one, it's enough to know the derivative to reconstruct the whole curve. So we will have this on the next slide. All these interest rates are just different representations. And for this instantaneous forward rate, it's actually the same if we define this rate via L and or via R. And a last thing was the short rate. And that guy was a little bit special. So if I redraw now this picture here, so let's say this is my zero Cooper bond curve as a function of maturity. So here's maturity, here is one. So I draw the curve, what is the bond price if I have to wait longer? Yeah. So then this curve is like that, okay. Then the R, which we define here, is actually the derivative at time little t. So that here is time little t. So at time little t. So that here is the slope minus, yeah. So this slope here is minus r of t. Okay, and knowledge of this object is not enough to know the whole curve. So it appears as if the short rate is just a small part of the interest rate curve, actually just a point. So actually, I just have 2 points. I know that the curve, 0.1 curve starts in 1, and I know that this is its slope. But there is a nice little trick that allows to reconstruct the whole curve from this object. That's maybe a nice little thing, yeah. And it's a bit ad hoc, but it's the reason why short rate models were widely popular in, say, 10 or 20 years ago. Yeah, they're still popular. okay, so. Now, if I have these objects, I can start building models. So models means, since these objects are random variables for a fixed time little g, I can start writing down, okay, how does it behave if little g evolves over time? Yeah, so I just write down SDEs for these objects. For example, here we can have something like that the L is an Itô process with some DT and some DW, okay? L is a family, yeah? So that is maybe L depends on the interval which you observe, yeah. So which means that you actually here have a stochastic process for every such interval, and these guys can move up and down, yeah, and you have stochastic movements of your interest rate curves. Alternatively, you can also write down a model here for the F, yeah. So that would be something like DF, yeah. Okay, so that F is a function of little t and capital T. So here I would have stochastic differential equations for every t, yeah? So that's actually very similar, but I'm not discretizing the curve. I have stochastic movement of the whole curves, yeah? So the curves can move up and down, and every point can move independently. So maybe there should be some connection between the curves, some correlation, yeah? So like a rubber band, yeah? So that it doesn't move too wild, yeah? But I can write down such a model. For the short rate model, I just model the movement of the R, yeah? Okay, and still we have this question mark. Okay, that is just the movement of a single point. So of this slope, how can it be that this reconstructs the whole curve, or that this is enough to reconstruct the whole curve? Okay, before I will answer this question, I would like to introduce one other object in this section on interest rate, and that was where we ended in the last session. Yeah, so now my small review is done. and that is an accrual account. And now comes a difference to what we did in these slides, because up to this point, all the interest rates were defined by looking at a fixed point, little t, yeah? And we just represented the Zierkover bond price curve in terms of different coordinates. So now I will also vary the little t. So my accrual account is the following. I invest in time t0, so let's have a small time axis here. In T0, I invest 1 unit of currency, okay, for a certain interval. So if this is 1 unit of currency, it means that after a certain interval, I receive back a little bit more to what I invested. I receive back 1 plus the interest rate. And now I contract this interest rate at the beginning of the period. So this means it is the interest rate from T0 to T1 as it was observed in T0. Okay. And maybe I just write delta T0 here. Okay. So this is what I receive back. And then I invest the whole amount again at the same point in time. So these arrows are actually at the same point in time. So I invest the whole amount at this at the same point in time here. And at a later point in time, I receive back a little bit more. Okay, so at T2. And what do I receive back at T2? I receive back the original investment, yeah, which was actually the blue stuff. Okay, multiplied with 1, you get back your original investment, plus the interest paid on this investment. So LT1, T2, and now this is observed in T1. So the difference is that I'm always contracting the interest rate at the beginning of the period. So here it is TCR, and here it is T1. So I'm building the product of 1 plus interest multiplied with time period, using the interest always from the beginning of the period. So that's the difference. So in the previous considerations, we always looked at TJ plus 1 observed in little t. Yeah. So it is not the little t. So actually, this is really a trading strategy. Yeah, invest always at the interest for the next period. So here I wrote this product in terms of the L. I could also write the product in terms of something else. So just keep in mind that actually this part here is just the ratio of the bond at the beginning divided by the bond at the end of the period. So this is just PTJ divided by TPTJ plus 1. Okay. So actually the product of this would be a telescope product. Yeah. And it would be just the bond at the beginning of the whole process, which is PT0, which is 1, divided by the bond at the end, which is PTI. Yeah. So it's just 1 divided by PTI. But now this is not a telescope product because I'm always using here the value at the beginning of the period. Yeah. So this is observed at PTJ. So the guys do not cancel, yeah, because the J is a different one for different Js. Okay, so that is here the product of these objects. So, and you know that now this ratio of the bonds can be expressed by different interest rates. I can also express it in terms of, say, the exponential over the integral of the instantaneous forward rate. And a product of an exponential is an exponential of the sum. And so we already made the remark that actually this here is a little bit like an Euler discretization. Well, an Euler discretization integrates. So what is the function that I'm integrating? It's the function FTT, okay? But I make the Euler discretization in the first argument. So it means in the first argument, so integral FTT, okay? But I now make an Euler discretization in the first argument. So it's actually not the Euler discretization exactly of FTT because I'm still integrating over the maturity. And so maybe write this here. Yeah. So with respect to the first argument, yeah, so, but maybe this here is just for the intuition. So this means that this is a little bit like the exponential of integrating from, okay, so now from the starting is T0 to TI FTT dt. So this is a little bit like integrating R, so integrating the short rate. Okay, so this object which we construct here, reinvesting for this fixed period is a little bit like the discrete analog of exponential integrate the short rate. So actually, and now this reminds you maybe of something. This is the numerator that we used in the Black-Scholes model. So that is this guy here. B of t is exponential integral from t zero to t r tau d tau. Well, actually, maybe I should add here b of t zero. Okay, so then b of t is the numerator that we used in the Black-Scholes model. So often we assume that b of t zero is just one, and then so we, in t zero we started in one. Yeah, so what we also did here. And then this is the discrete analog of this guy. And actually we will use this also as a numerator. Yeah, it is a different numerator. It uses discretizing and discrete investment. Well, one thing is a little bit disappointing here. I only know the value of this strategy at discrete times. So I would like to have this as a continuous process, yeah, in the same way as we have it here for all times. Well, but we can write it down, because what we actually do is we always invest in the next zero coupon bond. So if you look here, what we are doing is we invest over one period, a unit currency. So we invest in a zero coupon bond. So invest in a zero coupon bond. Yeah. So namely, we invest in the zero coupon bond that pays in the next period. Okay, that looks ugly, so maybe like make it like this. Yeah, so at time t0, I invest in the zero coupon bond that matures at time t1. Okay, and how many units do I pay? I use 1 divided by pt1 observed in t0 units of this, yeah, because then I invest just 1, and I receive at the end the payment 1 divided by pt1 observed in t0. So I can make this now a continuous time process by just saying that we invest here in this zero coupon bond that matures at the end of the next period. Yeah. So the process is now that I invest 1 unit in a zero coupon bond that pays at the end of t1. Okay. When I'm in t0, I would like to invest 1. So I divide this by how many units do we buy by this? Yeah. So this is, if you plug in little t being t0, this is 1. No. Then at time t1, I have pt1 t1 divided by pt1 t0. Yeah? So this here is actually now 1. Okay. Then I invest this in the next zero coupon bond. So I multiply with pt2 observed in little t. So, but now little t is t1. Yeah. So divided by pt2 observed in t1. Yeah. So here, little t is t1. So then this part here will be just 1. So, and we continue this investment. And in the end, I arrive at pt1. Okay, say this is a 1. Yeah, so I can just drop it. So in the end, I arrive at this 1 multiplied with pt2. So now time is t2 divided by, and I have this product here, okay? The product pt1 t0 multiplied with pt2, okay, so and so on. And 1 divided by the bond is actually exactly this part, yeah? So this here, these guys, is just this product. So I always invest in the zero coupon bond that matures at the end of the next period. So I define this as the so-called rolling bond. So it's a rolling investment in the shortest available bond on this time discretization. So actually the definition of R depends on this time discretization, which defines our investment strategy. And somehow we already have the intuition that if we make the time discretization very fine, yeah, if the time discretization goes to zero, yeah, the length of a period goes to zero, then this R of T will converge to this B of T. So now this object allows me to define a different interest rate, and that one is the backward looking rate, and sometimes also called the risk-free rate, but it's now misleading this term. It's just a performance rate of an index. Okay, well, an index is like S&P 500, NASDAQ stock index. Yeah, so you have something that moves. Yeah, a stock could also be some kind of index. So, and what is the performance of an index? Well, if you have some process that moves, so I have time here. Okay. And here I have the value, yeah, so let's have the value of the index. So how do I call the index here? I don't know. So let's call it V of T. Okay, then the V moves here. Then you would like to know what is the performance of the index between two times. Okay, say here is S and here is T. Well, how much percent have you gained over this time? Yeah? So that's actually like expressing an interest rate. I would like to know what is this part here? Yeah? What is the part that we have earned in percentage, so divided by the original value, and then maybe per time, because it makes a difference to wait 2 years instead of 1 year for the money. So what I would like to see is the performance of the index is how much do I get if I arrive in time t in addition to what I have invested in time s. Well, relative to where we started, so that is the percentage change, but also divided by time. Well, this looks very much like an interest rate, but now defined for the index. And the object that I now like to define is just this performance of our accrual account. Okay, so this is the accrual account at the end minus divided by the accrual account at the beginning minus one, yeah, so which is the same as end minus beginning divided by time. Okay. And this is now the backward-looking rate, because we can observe this rate when we have arrived at time capital T, and we look back, okay, so what have we earned? What have we realized in this account? So I can now define this interest rate from this accrual account. So this interest rate is a backward-looking rate in the sense that it's determined at the end of this period. Yeah. So this means while all the interest rates we have defined in this section so far were actually Fs measurable, whereas is the beginning of the period. Whereas is the observation point. Okay, so not the beginning of the period. And we defined the interest rates for periods in the future. Actually, we defined not only L of S and T observed in S, that is the interest rate for the period that just starts. Yeah? We defined many more, but everything was defined starting in S, so all the periods were larger than S. So now we look at this interest rate back from arriving in T. So this object here is only F T measurable. So our interest rate here is FT measurable. Actually, if you go back, you see that the fixing points are always the beginning of the periods. So actually it is FT and then the last discretization point before the time capital T. So it's actually FTK minus one measurable if the last point is TK. But that's just a subtle detail because we have a time discretization. So that is now the backward looking rate. So both rates that I have here on the slides, the forward rate, so what is the interest rate today in capital S? What do I get for this next period? And the backward rate, so if I have run through this period, what have I realized at the end? Both apply to the same period. For the special case that my time discretization is just a single period, so my time discretization is just consisting of the two points S and T, actually, the two rates are the same. Yeah, because here in my product, it's just one period. And it's just that R is 1 plus L. Yeah? So, and this formula gives you then just the L. Okay. This accrual account has a very common application, for example, in overnight index swaps. And often the time discretization that is used is very fine. For example, it is daily. Yeah? I accrue every day, say over three months, and then after 3 months, I look what have we realized. A little bit this is like generating an average, because you build this accrual and then you divide by time, it's building like an average. So a common application is to use this in overnight index swaps. And now there is a nice little lemma. I told you that if I have just one period, then the two rates agree. So if you have multiple periods, the two rates don't agree. You already see this at the measurability of the random variables. The one guy is known at the beginning. The other guy is known at the end. So there has to be a difference. But a nice thing is that the expectation in the sense of a risk-neutral valuation of both rates is the same. So this is, to make it precise, if we can choose the bonds, PT, as numerair. So now this is somehow linked to risk-neutral valuation. So I need some kind of assumption that I can perform risk-neutral valuation with the universal pricing theorem. So if I can choose the bonds PT as numerair, and if the universal pricing theorem applies, then the value of receiving the interest rate IS of T at the end of the period in capital T is the same as the value of receiving the forward rate LS of T fixed at the beginning of the period in the end of the period. So the time S value of paying the backward looking rate at the end of the period agrees with the time S value of paying the forward rate at the end of the period. So let me draw this here. So I have a period from S to T, and I get a payment here, so maybe like this, of L. Okay, and this L, because of this semicolon S, is known at the beginning of the period. So I just draw it as a fixed length arrow, it's known. But maybe the I, yeah, so the I, maybe I draw the I a little bit here to the left, is not known. So maybe I draw it a little bit wiggling, yeah. So it's not known, it's a stochastic process. Huh? And but I also get paid here the I of S T observed at the end of the T. Yeah. But the expectation in terms of risk neutral valuation of the two agrees. So what does this mean? So risk neutral valuation means I perform, I choose a numerator. Okay, and I perform the expectation of the value that I receive at the end divided by my numerator. And this should agree between the two. So it doesn't matter if I receive the backward looking rate or the forward rate at the end of the period. Yeah, so this here is the T. So oh, this guy doesn't have this. Maybe it would be nice if we also write the argument like this, but it's already encoded in the end. So I receive the backward rate in T. Yeah. So maybe I fix this here. Yeah. So this argument actually doesn't exist because it is just given by the fact that we run up to capital T. Yeah. So this here is the end of the accrual. So this is the claim of this lemma. Actually, the lemma is a little bit more general, as you have already maybe spotted. What I'm saying is that the value of paying the backward-looking rate at the end of the period is actually independent of the time discretization used in the accrual. So it doesn't make a difference if you accrue every day, every month, every week. Yeah, it is also the same if you just accrue once. And since we already observed that accruing once, the two rates agree. Yeah, so then this light green part follows that the expectation is the same. So for the value of the backward-looking rate, of paying the backward-looking rate, it doesn't matter in which way we accrue. But we have to make this strong assumption that we can choose the bonds PT as numerator. And if you have derivatives that have different collateralizations, that assumption is not always fulfilled. But currently, we just assume it. Yeah, and this lemma is actually a very nice one because it links the interest rate products that are well developed from 2020 on, the swaps on backward looking rate, it links them to the interest rate products that were popular before 2020, like the swaps on forward rates. Yeah. So as long as you are linear in this interest rate, there is in the value of the products not such a big difference. So let's prove this lemma, and this is actually easy. But here first, again, the warning, the lemma depends on the requirement that we can choose this bond as a numerator. So how does the proof go? If we can choose the bond for all maturities as a numerator, well, then I can also choose R as a numerator because R is just a rolling bond. It is just that I change the bond at certain times, yeah. It's still always a bond. So I can choose the R as a numerator. So R can be chosen as a numerator. And I can choose R as a numerator for any time discretization. So I just don't write the time discretization here. So choose the numerator R, and then I perform risk neutral valuation under this numerator. Yeah? So I assume now that I'm under the equivalent martingale measure corresponding to this numerator. So, and then you immediately see that if you divide I with the numerator N of T, so at the payment time, so this here is the payment time. Okay, so I of S was the performance. Plug it in. So what was I of S and T? It was the accrual account at the end minus the accrual account at the beginning. Divided by the accrual account at the beginning minus one, divided by the time. Okay, so that was our I of S. So now you divide this by the numerator, and you see that actually this RT here cancels, and 1 divided by RT gives me 1 divided by RT. So I have that it is 1 divided by RS minus 1 divided by RT divided by time, divided by the period length. So divided by the period length can move in front. And next thing you observe is I multiply with the numerator. Yeah? Valuation is divided by the numerator at the payment time. Take the expectation, multiply with the numerator at evaluation time. So I multiply with RS again. So this gives me a 1. Yeah? RS times 1 divided by RS is 1. And what's the second part? So the second part is just the payment of a zero coupon bond. Or a zero coupon bond with maturity capital T. So this means that I'm just evaluating the zero coupon bond which maturity T in S. Yeah? And you see that this valuation is then just, as I mentioned it in the beginning, 1 minus the zero coupon bond price of the zero coupon bond with maturity capital T observed in capital S divided by the time period length. And you see this is actually just the forward rate. The expectation is just the forward rate. And more or less. The important thing is that we see that this valuation is independent of the time discretization that is actually inside the R. Okay, it's just because I can choose then the corresponding R as a numerator. That was a session on the accrual account, and it is actually very helpful because this little lemma tells us that we can, when we later have swaps paying forward rates, we could also equivalently have swaps paying the performance of the accrual account, so paying this backward looking rate. So that's an important lemma if we consider products like floaters and swaps that pay linear functions of forward rates or the index performance. Now I like to conclude my session by telling you how you can actually get in the opposite direction. If you have interest rates, can you reconstruct the zero coupon bond price curve? Because all the things we did so far for the forward rate, for the instantaneous forward rate, for the continuously compounded forward rate, yeah, so simple rate, continuously compounded rate, all the things were different ways of expressing the zero coupon bond curve. And now I would like to know, okay, is this, can I invert this process? If I have interest rates, can I also get the zero coupon bond price curve back? because this is relevant if you now start building models on interest rates and you would like to calculate the zero coupon bond price. Well, and of course, I can have this for all the rates. So if I have the continuously compounded forward rate that expresses the zero coupon bond price in terms of the exponential function, so actually it is then the interest rate was the logarithm of the bond price curve, then it's just possible to express the bond price curve as the exponential function. The instantaneous forward rate was the derivative of the logarithm. So I just integrate this derivative to get the logarithm, take the exponential, and I get back the zero coupon bond price curve. So, and I perform the integral starting in little t because I know that PTT is one. Yeah, the logarithm of PTT being one is then zero. So there's no integration constant here. Integration constant is zero. And I integrate and I get the zero coupon bond price curve back. Well, for the forward rates, it's a little bit more subtle because I only have a discretization of the interest rate curve. So I only get the zero coupon bond price curve at discrete points. Yeah, so maybe I have to then fill my model up with a certain kind of interpolation. Yeah, but if I have this discretization, I can at least get the zero coupon bond price at the discrete points. So all these reconstruct the zero coupon bond price curve, the last one only in a discretized manner. And the short rate can also be used to reconstruct the zero coupon bond price curve. Okay, so we already know that this is impossible because if I have just a single point, which is one, and the slope, I just know a little bit of the curve and I do not know the whole curve. But actually the trick that does this is very similar to what we had in the previous lemma. For the short rate, there is a small trick, and we just assume that we know the short rate under its martingale measure. So the trick is, if the short rate process is known under the equivalent martingale measure Qn, where actually n is the numerator built by investing at the short rate, so always invest in an infinitesimal small period, then you know from the short rate process the numerator process. And the numerator process is also just a scalar process which just models a single point in time. But if you know the numerator, then you know the bond prices, because the bond prices, the value of a zero coupon bond paying in capital T, observed in little t, is just the expectation under the equivalent martingale measure of paying one unit in capital T, conditional expectation to Ft. Yeah, so one divided by the numerator at capital T. So if you know the numerator, and the numerator is just a single scalar process, you can, of course, construct all the bond prices by valuation. But the thing is that you have to know this scalar process under the equivalent martingale measure. And this trick for the short rate model is a little bit ad hoc, because it not only says I know the short rate process, it also says that I know the short rate process under the measure where the short rate is actually the numerator, so the exponential of the integral of the short rate is actually the numerator. So this is, while in the other models, you can actually say, I would like to know the stochastic process for these models under the real physical objective probability measure. And then I apply Gersanov's theorem to convert the process to the equivalent martingale measure. Here you just immediately postulate that you can write down the short rate process under the equivalent martingale measure. But this trick was actually then done. Yeah, all the people just wrote down the short rate process under the equivalent martingale measure. So they just wrote down different models. And then they had a tool to model the whole interest rate curve by just a single scalar product, by just a single scalar process, very similar to what Black-Scholes did. Yeah? They just had a dr equals blah, 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 something, and they could derive nice analytic formulas and so on. So this trick was, or this way of introducing or modeling the interest rate curve was then the basic tool. Yeah, so that was then very, very popular because it was so similar to what was known until then. So you have just a single scalar product, a scalar process, very tractable. And of course, we also have the same for our accrual account. Yeah, so the same holds for our accrual account. It was what we just proved in the lemma. So if you know the stochastic process of R of this accrual account under the equivalent martingale measure R, then it's enough knowledge to reconstruct the whole interest rate curve, yeah, all 0, bond prices. And actually, this thing that is here on the slide also gives you now a little bit more intuition how the models I had there, LIBOR market model, forward rate model, HGM model, are linked. So, because once your model models the numerator, you can actually forget about all the quantities and just write down the stochastic process of the numerator, because this object is enough to reconstruct all the interest rates and all the interest rate curves. So that's the reason why I can also write a LIBOR market model as a short rate model. I set up a LIBOR market model for the forward rates. I define the numerator. I forgot about all the rates. From the numerator, I calculate the evolution of the short rate, and that gives me a one-to-one link to reconstructing the all zero coupon bond prices. So put differently, if we know the dynamic of the numerator under its equivalent martingale measure, then we can construct all zero coupon bond prices, and we can reconstruct the whole interest rate curve. Nevertheless, this approach is a little bit ad hoc, and it's not the approach that I actually like. So that concludes my session now on interest rates. So discount factors were somehow the basic object. So a discount factor is just the same as the zero coupon bond price. Yeah. So the discount factor, so the zero coupon bond price is something sometimes called the discount factor, the discounting from time little t to capital T. So these things are somehow the basic object. Everything was derived from this. So as a programmer, it looks a little bit as if we store an interest rate in terms of the zero coupon bond prices, and then we set up method to calculate the interest rates from this object. So for a programmer, it looks a little bit as if you would do it like this. You store discount factors. Okay, you store discount factors in your data model. And then you have different methods to calculate interest rates. But this view that is here is not always very good from a programming design, because sometimes you like to perform interpolation on different entities, and maybe it's better to store the entity that performs the interpolation. For example, the logarithm of the discount factor or the forward rate or whatever. We will talk about this in a different session. I like to finish by actually mentioning a few conventions. This is not so important for the mathematical finance part, but it's important if you apply this in industry, in practical applications. All these interest rates, they come with a lot of conventions. And if you have the conventions wrong, it's maybe that your model does not calibrate to the correct data, because your model is from the mathematics fine, but it's fed with the wrong data because some convention is different. One such convention is the day count convention. And on my slides, I'm often a bit sloppy. Yeah, you could say I'm a bit sloppy when I express the period length T minus S. Yeah. So interest rates are measured in a unit per time. Yeah. So if we talk about units here, I will talk about units later, but the physical unit of a zero coupon bond is actually one currency. Yeah. So for example, 1 euro. Okay, so that is the physical unit. So the physical unit of the interest rate, L, is, okay, what is L? Is it euro per time? No, it's not euro per time. If you go back to the definition, it was the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. So that is euro, divided by the bond at the end. Right? Yeah, but divided by the bond at the end. So that is euro divided by euro. So that is unit less. Yeah. Divided by time. Yeah? So that is 1 divided by time. So that is the physical unit of an interest rate. It is a unitless object, yeah? A multiplicative factor per time. To calculate this time, we need to calculate the difference of two dates. So end date minus beginning date. And actually, this minus looks like as if it is the operator between two real numbers. Yeah, so 1.5 years minus 1.1 year is 0.4 years. But this is not true. T and S are dates. And so the minus here is, in Java, a function that operates on two dates. Yeah, so it's an operator defined between two dates. And this is an operator that maps the set of dates to a real number. And we have to define this day count fraction. So actually it is rather the year fraction. We have to define this year fraction operator. Yeah. So, and this day count fraction or year fraction is defined using different conventions. And these conventions are called day count conventions. There are many different such conventions. Some exist for historical reasons because people were just lazy calculating this by hand. Yeah, so it actually comes from the time when this was maybe not done with a computer. And I have in the code different day count conventions. So there is an interface that just specifies that there is this function which gets two dates and calculates this floating point number. And you can have a look at different day count conventions if you like. Yeah. So for us in mathematical finance, it's maybe not so interesting, but if you need this in practice, you have to be aware that they are important. They just are scaling factors. So there are here different day count conventions. So there is here this interface that there is a day count fraction, a year fraction, and a day count convention to be defined. And for example, there is here 3360, a day count convention that calculates the day count in a certain way. Yeah. So you see here that a year has 360 days and a month has 30 days. And then there is some stuff done. And the year fraction is then just this divided by 360. Okay, so that looks like a crude one. Yeah, so actual ISTA is maybe a nice one, but it's a little bit complicated. And the complication comes from actually leap years. Yeah, so if you have a leap year where there is February 29, so actually what is the February 28 to February 28 of the next year? Is it 1 year? Yeah, from the same February to the same February, or is it 1 year plus 1 day? Yeah. So this is the stuff that is behind this. And another convention is the business day calendar. Well, we started from looking at a tenor discretization. Yeah. So in these times were actually the periods for our interest rates. Actually, the world is a little bit more complicated because every such point is actually sometimes 3 points or even more, because there is the period start and the period end. So period start and period end agree in the sense that the start of the next period is the end of the previous period. But then there could be the fixing date and the payment date, and there could be a little bit 2 days more, 2 days less. There could be small differences. And all these dates are actually by convention on a business date. Yeah, so they are not on a Sunday. So somehow this is then linked to a holiday calendar. So it can depend on where you are, if you are in New York or in Frankfurt. And then there's also, if you perform some rounding to the next business day, a rolling convention that defines this rounding. This is only important if you set up a financial product and you want to generate these time discretizations. And actually for us, it's not important because we just consider this as given. Yeah. So somebody has set up the time discretization and we consider it as given. But if you are interested, there is a schedule generator that generates such schedule and takes care that everything is on a business day. So you can also look this up in the code. Yeah. So there's code on these conventions here. There are different business day calendars, the Target 2 calendar, the New York calendar, and so on. And there is an interface that performs this rolling convention. So it performs also checking, is this a business day? And then also adjusting a date to round to the next business day. And what is the next business day? Is it the day before or the day after, and so on? That is my session on interest rates. So a small recap that there are some conventions. We started our session by looking at the zero coupon bond as the fundamental object. And we derived all interest rates from this zero coupon bond and all relations. But we already had the remark that this zero coupon bond actually does not exist on the market. It is an idealized product. So actually, you very rarely can buy a zero coupon bond. So the financial products that are traded on the market are different ones. So the zero coupon bond we used was just some idealized object in terms of which we can express all the stuff. But now we have to look at the financial products that are actually traded. And then in a next session, we will actually ask ourselves, how can I find the values of the zero coupon bonds if I observe these products on the market? But in order to do this calibration, deriving the zero coupon bond prices from what we observe, I have to define the financial products that we observe. So let's start with the simple products without optionality. So far we have just looked at one, the zero coupon bond, and maybe also the accrual account, which is also a kind of financial product. And the first one is the coupon bond. So the name zero coupon bond came from the word, from the fact that this bond was not paying a coupon. But usually it's not that you buy such a bond and he has a huge payment at the end. Yeah. So usually it is that he has some intermediate payments in between. So for example, every year you get some payment and then in the end you get a final payment. And in this setup, it is that in the end we pay one unit. And in between, we pay coupons CI. So a coupon bond with coupons CI has a certain tenor structure. And for simplification here, I just assume that the tenor structure is a time discretization. So the period end of the previous period is the period start of the next period, and so on. And also you see here that I'm sloppy and I have here my minus operator. So this is the day count fraction that is staying there, because the minus operator is the operator between 2 days. Yeah. So the coupon is multiplied with the day count fraction of the period length. And then this is paid at the end of the period. So this here is the period from TI to TI plus one. And in every period, I pay the coupon CI, so given coupon CI, multiplied with the period length. And then if the period is the final period, so that one here is the final period, then at the end, I get one. In addition, okay, so that is like a zero coupon bond which pays one unit in TN, but in addition you get also in other points in time a certain maybe small payment CI times the time period length. So I have here in minus one payments. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Because I always pay at the end of the period, so the payment starts in T2. Maybe that's a bit strange, but okay. What's the value of this coupon bond? Well, actually, you have just different payments. And all the payments are known in time little t. So all the payments are known beforehand. So if I would like to value this in little t, these are just small zero coupon bonds. Okay, so receiving one unit in time TI plus one has the value PTI plus one observed in little t. So receiving one unit in TI plus one has the value P zero coupon bond price. Yeah, so this here is the zero coupon bond price. So the value of receiving one unit in TI plus one So, but in TI plus one, I don't get a one, I get CI times TI plus one minus TI. So I just receive that many units of this zero coupon bond. So I receive that many units here of this zero coupon bond. So the value of this coupon payment is just CI times TI plus one minus TI times the value of the zero coupon bond. So now I have a portfolio of all these plus a final payment of the final zero coupon bond, which is here. And there's also, maybe I should also draw this final coupon payment here. Yeah. So at the last period end, I get a coupon plus the final payment. So I can value just this zero coupon, this coupon bond as a portfolio of zero coupon bonds. And that's very nice. And that's the scheme that's actually now going on for all the linear products, that we can express the value of this financial products in terms of the value of a zero coupon bond, which then later allows us to invert this valuation formula and get from the value of this financial product the value of the zero coupon bond. But then we, in order to solve these equations, because we have many zero coupon bonds here, I need many equations, I need many financial products. This is also a bit on market convention. Maybe I just make a small comment. What I have written here is the so-called dirty price of a coupon bond. And the thing is that actually I'm here assuming that my little t, the point where I value this, is actually smaller than the first payment date. Yeah. So because at this point, T2, a zero coupon bond payment has occurred. So if you move with the little t to this point, it would be that you just value what comes in the future. So if you look, for example, in the internet for a price of a bond, this price would have a jump the day after the coupon has been paid. Yeah? Because before the date, the coupon was part of the financial product. After the date, the coupon is not part of the financial product. Well, that is the value of the future cash flows. And that's from a mathematical finance point of view, the value we would like to calculate here. But maybe from a quotation, it's not a nice way of expressing the value. And there is a certain rule to actually remove the coupon on a time proportional basis, and that is the so-called accrued interest. So the accrued interest is actually defined as a fraction, the time fraction of the coupon. Yeah? That's not a valuation, it's just a definition. Yeah? It's just a linear interpolation of the coupon, but not of the coupon value, of the coupon amount. And there is the so-called clean price. The clean price is just the price that we have just calculated, the dirty price. And from that, we remove this linear interpolation of the coupon, which removes this jump. That's just the quotation convention, but I just mentioned this because you have to be careful. If you observe a bond price, if the bond price is actually the dirty price or the clean price, so if the coupon has been removed or not. Actually, this clean price is only possible in this sense if the coupon is already known. Yeah. So if I pay a floating rate coupon, or if I pay the coupon derived from the backward looking rate, yeah, then this definition would not be possible in this way. Yeah. So, but just as a remark, if you look at data, you have to be a little bit careful. Sometimes the prices are modified in a certain way. The next financial product is the floating rate bond, or let's take a look at a floater. So I here on this slide, I actually dropped the final payment of the final amount one. So maybe I just add this. Yeah. So also starting with a time discretization. So we start here a given tenor time discretization. So here we have a discretization of say periods. Yeah. TI. So I can write these periods here. Okay. So in the previous example, at the end of each period, I pay a fixed coupon, CI, multiplied with the period length. And here, I don't pay a fixed coupon, I pay the forward rate. So I pay the forward rate L. Yeah. So this means, let me draw this a little bit wiggling here. This is the forward rate fixed at the beginning of the period. So this is the same situation as in our accrual account. I do not know the payment at time little t, so I do not know the payment at time little t, when I evaluate this, the payment is fixed at the beginning of the period, so which is here ti. Okay, so it is the interest rate for this period, and it is stochastic in the sense that I do not know it in little t. Apart from this, this financial product is the same as this coupon bond. Yeah, well, there's another difference, but it's similar. Yeah, I pay just the coupon multiplied with the time, the period length. Okay, so multiplied with the period length. And then I also multiply here with a notional. Yeah, so that is not so important. So there is some notional here. I multiply with a constant. Actually, this is a bit stupid that I use this here because I will later use n of t for the numerator. But don't be confused. This is just a scaling constant. Instead of 1 euro, I have n euros in this payment. And also, I could say here also have the floating rate bond. So if I have a floating rate bond, then I would pay plus 1 unit in I plus 1 equals n, so at the end of the last period. Yeah, so that would make it analog to the fixed coupon bond. Now this is a coupon bond that pays coupons. So in the end, I pay also one. But with a floating rate coupon. So floating because it is uncertain until the beginning of the period. So I will only value this coupon payment because we know how to value this part. Yeah. So we know how to value this. So it's not so interesting. So just value, what do we get as a value if I pay the forward rate at a future period at the end of this period? So that is the value of the floater. So, and this little theorem tells us that the value of the floater is actually the sum of all payments. Multiplied with the notional, yeah. So that is just the notional, just the scaling factor. And then the value of the payment is here. So the value of the payment is this part. And that looks really nice because it is just the size of the coupon payment, L times delta TI, multiplied with the zero coupon bond. Yeah. So this is S for the coupon bond. Yeah, recall for the coupon bond, that was the coupon bond. Recall for the coupon bond, it was the sum of all payments, the coupon multiplied with the zero coupon bond at the payment time. And now the claim is that here it's the same, the sum of all payments, the coupon multiplied with the zero coupon bond at the payment time observed at evaluation time. There's a slight difference here. Of course, if I evaluate this, this have to be f little t measurable. It is a quantity that I want to know in f little t. So f little t measurable is fulfilled here for my zero coupon bond. But my interest rate, which I pay, is stochastic. So here it's also the forward rate as I observe it today. And that's really a strange thing, yeah, because I have the product of two random variables, and the expectation of a product of two random variables is not the product of the two expectations in general. But here it looks a little bit as if this is the case. Well, this is the case because of a special property of the forward rate. And it is not the case if the payment would occur at a different time. This will be convexity adjustments, which we will do in a different session. So, and if you plug in the definition of L, then you will see that actually this here is a telescope sum, and the value of the floater is just the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end, multiplied with the notional. So I just have a minute left, so let me just prove this very quickly, but we will pick up at this point next time. And but let's just go through the proof, because it's a nice result that we can value the floating rate bond by this formula, just in terms of zero coupon bonds, as we observe them in little t. So I have two versions of this. Yeah. So let's look at the single payment. Yeah, it's enough to look at the single payment because the sum of all payments is just the sum of the values. So the value of the sum of the payments is just the sum of the values. So I just look at the single payment, which is this here, and plug in the definition of L. So L is the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end divided by the bond at the end, divided by the time, but the time is multiplied here, so by the period length, so that cancels. So I just have that this gives me this ratio. Okay. So this payment is an FTI measurable random variable. So I pay this here in TI plus one, but it's already known in TI. So conditional to this time TI, this is a constant. It is stochastic before, but conditional to TI, I know it. So I can just value this conditional to TI. So the value conditional to TI is this amount here multiplied with the bond that pays in TI plus one observed in TI. If I multiply this with this, you see actually that this guy cancels. And this is just the difference of the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. So this is just a portfolio of two bonds. And the value of this portfolio at an earlier time is just the value of this portfolio at an earlier time. So it's just at an earlier time, the difference of the value of the two bonds. Okay, and there it is. This is our telescope sum. It's just the difference of the value of a portfolio of the bond at the end minus the bond at the beginning. And that proves the result. I have a second alternative proving this using risk-neutral valuation. So we choose the numerator and then perform expectation. The numerator in this here is just the bond at the end, but that we can discuss next time. So that was it, yeah? So we can also now value floating rate bonds. We have fixed coupon bonds, floating rate bonds, and actually a swap is just the difference of the two. So we already have some simple interest rate products. Thanks.